Good evening, Perry.
I own a motel not too far from here, and you'd be welcome to spend the night in one of the empty rooms if you'd like.
Oh, it burns! Oh, it burns! And I'm the devil!
From the haunted heartland and the great American Midwest, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever the case may be, in all 24 time zones worldwide covered now by this program. I'm Brian Corey, and the program, of course, is the Necronomicast, bringing you the horror of Hollywood and beyond. We are glad to have you. In the darkness of a cold autumn night, we hearken back to the days when the great Art Bell would bring you the best of the paranormal with his show, Coast to Coast. Every October, around Halloween, he would broadcast his fantastic Ghost to Ghost, featuring live callers with their true paranormal experiences. As a tribute to Art, who has been in contact with us and is doing well, I might add, we bring you this special two-part installment of the Necronomicast with the newest and most captivating of paranormal researchers and reporters, Dark Waters. His appearances on Coast to Coast, Darkness Radio, and his own YouTube channel have been instrumental in establishing him as the most exciting new voice in the world of the paranormal. If you are listening to this episode during the day or at work, on your morning commute, or when you're just goofing around or doing chores around your house, I ask you to pause and listen another time. Just turn it off. Because these episodes, they're meant to be experienced late at night when the rest of the world is sleeping. These episodes are dedicated to the cross-country truck driver hauling freight and pushing weight overnights. To the musicians packing up their gear after a long night in the club and taking the long, lonely drive home. And to the college student burning the midnight oil, cramming for a test in the wee hours of the morning. This world is a different place when the rest of the planet is sleeping. So, I invite you to take a plunge into the world of Dark Waters and his true tales of Bigfoot, of Dogman, demons, vampires, and all things that are unexplained in our world. Here he is, calling in on our Necronomicast Newsmaker Hotline. We've got him here. He's been on Coast to Coast. He's been on Darkness Radio. He's been all over. And we have him here tonight for you. Dark Waters. DW, how are you, sir?
Oh, man, I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing really good. And so I'm in the cornfields of Nebraska, and you are in New Orleans, Louisiana. A very.
I'm in the swamps. Down in the swamps, below sea level.
Yeah, how are you guys doing down there, first off, with all the rain and everything?
Well, luckily, we didn't get anything of any significance outside of our, you know, the pumps that pump the water out of the city being broken. Everything is going well. So as long as we don't get a hurricane, the whole city won't flood.
Good.
And so far, we've been able to dodge the bullet.
See, we have to dodge the bullet of the tornadoes. So I was watching all these swirling clouds coming, you know, towards you guys in Florida and Texas and everything. And so I'm glad you're okay. And we're able to talk tonight. Hey, DW, for people that listen to our show that haven't experienced you, we'll get into your background, but tell us about your show and why they call you the king of YouTube horror.
Well, I guess the best way to describe what I do and what my show is I take the opportunity to talk to as many people as humanly possible. I have a public phone number. They call me. Some people are nice. Some people are sweet. Some people are drunk. Some people are crazy. And they share their stories with me. And then what I do is I sit at my home computer which really is a laptop. I kind of upgraded just recently, but with a laptop. And I would recreate that story. Every minute detail of their story, I would recreate it in an audio format, which would allow you as a listener to experience the exact same thing they experienced. And I focus on making sure that I capture every emotion that that person has had. So if they say, you know, I was sitting at home alone and I started to hear these footsteps creaking down the stairs, and I'll stop them in the story and I'll say, well, what did that make you feel like? Hmm. And it's amazing how once you are able to put a person back into that moment, because our minds are like these video recorders, we can rewind back to time and actually relive it. Once they start reliving that encounter, they give you the most insane details about what happened to them. People will recall, you know, tapping their foot on the floor. You know, they'll be able to recall, you know, darting their eyes left to right. They'll tell you, you know, my ears were sweating. I was so afraid, you know. So I capture all those details, and then I put it in a format, and it turned out to be a smash hit. I mean, people love it. I mean, absolutely love it.
When I'm listening to you, you've obviously got a great voice for what you do. It's you've got a great timbre and sound to your voice, and you really do have a flair for the dramatic, but in a real concrete, you know, personal, truthful way. Like you say, you're recreating these stories that people have been telling you. Do you have a background in broadcasting?
Well, I did. I did a 5-year stint in radio after Hurricane Katrina hit here, and you know, your life is shuffled around. Did a 5-year stint in radio, which kind of let me develop those skills. But the skill that I think that's most valuable is just being a down-to-earth person. Hmm. One of the things that I've discovered is that we all are alike. I don't care where you're from. And I talk to people all over the world. Everyone's the exact same. We want the same things for ourselves, for our families, for our children. We're all the same. Now, we have different experiences. And if you can capture that experience and then build a rapport with that person based on what we have, you know, the similarities that we have, then you can really kind of crack the shell and get inside of what's really going on in a person's life. So, you know, I have the broadcast background, but also I just pride myself on being a down-to-earth human being who really cares about people. And typically what you find with this horror genre where people kind of, especially on YouTube, where people are trying to get stories, it's a content-based thing. So the more content they can put out, the more views they get, so they neglect the human being aspect of it. They just say, let me get you on and record you and hear what happened to you. And then a person never hears from that guy again. Well, when they call me, they tell me their story. In order for me to even vet their story, I have to talk to a person 5-6 times. So I tell them, I say, hey, man, once I call you once and we talk, you're going to get tired of talking to me because I'm going to start digging into your world and digging into your life and talking to your wife and talking to your kids. And at the end of all that, we'll have a relationship and a friendship, and also I'll have the true story. And so that's kind of the process that I go through.
Well, that's interesting because when I first started listening to you and I heard you on different shows, I was struck by like this authenticity. I can tell that when you are talking to whatever host you're talking to and you're telling about these stories and how they affected you, it comes off so authentic, and you can't fake that. And so I really appreciated that when I was listening, and to have you on the show and kind of get these stories and talk about you and everything in New Orleans and your experiences, it's going to be great for our listeners, and I'm super excited about it. What brought you to stories of the paranormal?
Storytelling. You know, over time, I've been asked that question so many times that it forced me to really sit down and think about it. Mm-hmm. And the more I thought about it, it's really kind of this hybrid thing, right? So the art of storytelling itself was taught to me by a mentor of mine named Joe Baker in Baton Rouge. And he taught me this one thing. He would say, hey, man, you know, when you want to tell somebody something, don't just tell them, you know, like you're dumb or you're silly or you're stupid or I want you to do this. We'd always say, hey, the best way not to offend somebody is to tell them something in a story. And I was thinking about that the night, and I was like, you know, this guy really taught me how to do it because he would do that to me. So he started me on the road of actually communicating in that manner. And then when you take that, which I can honestly say I've mastered just by just by living life, you end up mastering those kind of skills. And then when you take my childhood experiences and growing up in New Orleans, and you combine that storytelling aspect with the paranormal experiences, you kind of it's a kind of natural blend, and kind of a natural meld. So for me personally, my paranormal experiences started when I was 12 years old, in Mississippi, where, at my family's property, where I was leaving from, just to paint the picture for everybody who's listening, if you would imagine for a second you're looking down on a plot of land, right, like you're in the sky, hovering in the sky looking down, and below you are two houses, one on the left, one on the right, and they're about 45 yards apart, right? The one on the right is offset to the back, to where it's kind of sits a little bit further back than the other one.
Okay.
And towards the back of that property was a basketball goal with a light on the right-hand side. And on the left-hand side, towards the back of that property, was the shed that has always been haunted. In between the house on the left and my shed is like a swing set, right? So that's the layout of my family's property in Mississippi. And so we had what we call the girl's house and the boy's house. And the family was so big that, with so many grandchildren that, the girls slept in one house, which is the one on the left-hand side, and all the guys and uncles slept in the right-hand, the house on the right, which we call the boys' house. So, I'm over with my aunties and having dinner and hanging out and, just talking. It gets to be pretty late. So I'm like, okay, I need to go over to the other house. Now, the thing about moving from one house to the other is if you go around to the front door, there's, ample light because there's a street light. But when you go around the back door, there's literally no light there. The only light that you get is the light from this light pole that's way towards the back of the property, which is by a basketball goal. So I'm moving from that left house to that right house, and I don't know what made me do this, Brian. I can't tell you what made me go around the back side of that house, but I went around the back side. I think it's like kind of a thing of habit. You do it out of habit because in the daytime you move in that direction. So I'm moving around the back side, going to the back door, and about halfway along the length of the house, I start to get this feeling that something is watching me, and it's watching me from the darkness out by the basketball goal. And I'm 12 years old, man. I'm not an adult, and I'm not the most rational thinking person. I'm just a kid. And so I stop and look out that way. And from beyond the light, like behind the light, you see at the height of the basketball rim, which is how high this up is up, you see these two like glowing, like it was almost like flaming, glowing red dots, but it looked like dots because it was so far away at first. And that really caught my attention. I'm standing there, I'm like, what is that? But it's behind the light. Now, I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where there's a light shining, but beyond that light is nothing but darkness. So you can see that dark, you can see it beyond that light. And then this thing starts to move forward through the light and into the darkness again. And it's when it hits the light, it's a black shadow. I mean, 9.5, 10 feet tall. And these eyes are like red, like scorching red. And it's constantly moving towards me. And I can't tell you why I didn't run. I can't tell you why I was frozen. I really can't tell you why I stood there like that. But I stood there. And I know I was terrified. I still remember, like, as I'm telling you the story now, the goosebumps are starting to run up my legs. And
I'm entranced with, like, the story. I'm picturing these 9-foot tall eyes kind of peering at you through the darkness.
Right. And so, it literally comes through the light. And it comes through the light and then back into the darkness. And, like, I hate telling this story because as I tell this story, I always feel it again.
Yeah.
And, like, right now, my right leg, you feel the goosebumps starting up my leg. But anyway, so I'm ignoring it, and I'll pray about it later. But it comes through from the darkness, through the light, and back into the darkness. And now I'm standing there freaking out, man. Like, I'm literally freaking out. I want to run, but I can't run. And as this thing gets closer and closer, I start to hear this super familiar sound. On the girls' house, where all the girls are and everybody is, there's these wooden steps. And when you go down these steps, the way it's set up is the first step you take, it rocks the steps forward, and then they kind of rock back a little bit and bang against the concrete foundation. Mm-hmm. So you hear a boom when you take the first step. Then when you go, every time you step down, it's boom, 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 and it's three steps. So I hear boom, 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 which is somebody coming down the steps, and then I hear the footsteps of someone running. And literally, when I tell you I'm tackled and picked up like a football dummy, I'm hit and I'm picked up like a football dummy and ran into the other house, the one I was headed to, brought into the bedroom and sat on the bed. I look up, it's one of my older cousins, one of my favorite cousins at that. And he's like, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" And I'm like, "Yeah, what was that?" And he was like, "Just stay here, don't move." And he runs out. I mean, literally flies out of the room. And for like the next 10 minutes, you just hear this commotion and this talking and everybody's moving around. And then he comes back and he says, "I'm going to stay here with you. I'm going to sleep in this chair with you. You sleep in the bed tonight." And I'm sitting asking him, "Hey, bro, what is that? What was that thing? What was it?" He said, "Man, go to bed. Just go to sleep. We'll talk about it later." Well, he never told me what it was. And I didn't find out till later on that my grandmother on that side of the family was a hoodoo practitioner. And not like, you know, a person who dabbles in hoodoo. Like, she was off the chain hoodoo priestess. The real deal. And, you know, I didn't know this. Now, some of my older cousins knew this, and he was one of them who knew it, but I didn't know it. Mm-hmm. And so that was my first paranormal experience at 12 years old, which, I mean, was extremely frightening. Well, you skip from 12, we get to 16, 17, I'm babysitting, and I see my first doppelganger. You get from 16, 17 to my 20s, where I'm literally driving, and I don't think I've ever told you about this story, bro. I'm literally driving from Huntsville, Alabama, and I have a green Jeep Cherokee. That cat just scared the hell out of me. Oh, my God. Dude, this black cat just scared the hell out of me. Uh-oh. Oh, my God. Uh-oh. All right, so I'm driving a green Jeep Cherokee, and I'm headed from Huntsville back to New Orleans, and, bro, I promise you, I had drunk coffee. I was wide awake. And time just gone. I would say it had to be from outside of Mobile, Alabama, all the way into Mississippi. Like, I just don't remember what happened. You know, I just don't remember what happened. I know I didn't fall asleep, but I just don't remember what happened. So I've always had weird, crazy stuff happen to me, almost cursed. Weird, crazy stuff happening to me. Even when I was in college, I would lay in the bed and feel like something was sitting on my chest. And that's when I first learned the power of prayer and how prayer would, you know, reject these things and give them to leave me alone. And all the way up until what I do now, doing this as Dark Waters, the persona Dark Waters, I've learned more and more and more to the point that I now come to the realization that the spiritual warfare, the spiritual battle that goes on in this world, is so powerful that, and there's some entities that are so powerful that you just really, really have to be careful. And it's amazing how talking to an individual on the phone can provoke some form of activity in your life. So I've just learned so much since I've been doing this. It's been such a great journey for me. It's been a journey that's taught me about myself, significant amounts of information about who I am as a person. It strengthened my faith to a level where I can honestly say I don't think my spirituality and faith in God would ever be this strong without the things that I've encountered. So, I mean, it's really been an amazing journey for me. And to say that, you know, a little black boy from the hood in New Orleans can actually talk to people all around the world and make friends with people all around the world, and then has the ability to communicate those stories to people from other people all around the world and be successful at it. I mean, it's just a great journey. I love doing it. And there's nothing that'll stop me from doing it.
Amazing. You know, I was listening to you talk, and I've heard you on other shows, and when you said that, you know, you're able to talk and share stories and conversations with people all over the world, it makes me wonder if the age that we're living in, with technology the way it is and the way we're able to connect, and I know that you have an aversion, and we're not going to get into specifics at all because I know you don't want to, about demonic activity and stories like that. I know we don't even want to go there. But I'm wondering if the way technology is the way it is nowadays, and we're able to connect all over the world, that there just seems to be such an increase in negativity with message boards and, you know, people being anonymous, posting things, and cyberbullying and all the hate. I mean, the internet does a lot of good, don't get me wrong, but with all the hate that's spread around the world because of technology, and you kind of touched on it with things opening up doors, just even talking about it over the phone, over Wi-Fi, over wires crisscrossing the world. What do you think about that? Like, we're almost like making an antenna, it seems like, for darker entities and darker, you know, realities out there.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know what, man, that's an amazing segue, and it's a great question. You are, I think you're 1,000% right, and here's what I've realized and come to realize, that when people talk about spirits, right, you know, and spiritual energy, and mm-hmm. the spirit of people's spirits, there's no limitation on how that energy can move, right? You know, energy is neither created or destroyed. So we know that it to be a fact. So there's no limitations to as how that energy can move. And what I've discovered, based on doing this and just having run-ins with certain groups of people who didn't really want to see me be successful, just some people are mentally ill, and some people who've had really, really bad paranormal attachments, what I've discovered is it's almost like a spirit can move. And what I mean, like, not like an individual spirit. It's almost like a flood washing over people. And the best way to describe it, like a flood of water washing over a group of people, and they all behave the same way. And what I alluded to that earlier when I said I realize now that it's spiritual warfare, because just today, literally just today, and I wish I could play this message for you. I got a call from a guy. He commented on YouTube because I did a video about Dogman, where this guy was listening to T.D. Jakes. This is not my story. This is the guy's story. Mm-hmm. He's listening to T.D. Jakes at his father's house in Mississippi, where his father had died, and he's got in this terrible state. He's listening to T.D. Jakes, you know, and trying to find some kind of solace or comfort in this, and he has a Dogman encounter, but Dogman walks away because of what was going on with the preacher. I still haven't put all that together, but the guy hears the story, right, and it triggers something in him. And he just goes on his rant and rave and says, oh, you know, those pastors are part of the Vatican. They hate you. They do this. They do that. And at first, my friend, Brian, I'm going to tell you, at first when I read the comment, I was like, yo, this guy's tripping. Like, he's bugging out. Like, something's wrong with him. Like, he's crazy. Mm-hmm. But then when I heard the message, that's when it hit me. That's when it really hit me. The message, you could feel the intensity. See, that story triggered something inside him spiritually. And whatever negative spirituality he had, it offended it. And so, I mean, the message almost sounds demonic. He's like, yeah, dog orders, you're a fake and you're a fraud. And it was so vicious and so much vitriol in the message from a person who doesn't even know me. We've never held a conversation. It was so bad that I called him and called him back because I was like, yo, this dude's bugging. I don't even know him. But I wanted to have that conversation with this man because I wanted to see if I can sense what was going on with him. And so what I've discovered is you are 100% correct that there are certain things that happen that trigger these negative spiritual entities that are attached to people, associated with people. Sometimes you see it kind of moving in the world, like in a massive way. You know, like, for example, let's take politics. I don't care who a person voted for president. I don't care if you're a Democrat or if you're a Republican. I don't care what you are. But if you turn on YouTube and you were to watch, you know, people marching down the street where you got like one group of people fighting and Antifa and this other group of people fighting, and you actually look at those people, I mean, you really, really look at those people, you will see that spirit. It's almost like, you know, how does 1,000 people come together? They may be paid, but you know, how do 1,000 people come together to go out and provoke violence against other people? It's a spirit that's moving amongst those people. And I believe that the technology is working in both ways, in a good way and a bad way. It's a battle, and you see that battle. I think it's being played out in front of us now more than it's ever been played out before in the history of the world, because we have access to see it. because everything is recorded, because everything is documented, now we're seeing it. And it's just going to be a little while before people actually wake up to it and realize that, wow, everything is a spiritual battle. I don't mean to be blabbing, but that's just where I stand on that.
No. I totally understand exactly what you're saying. And you can see it. There's this like white hot hatred that just washes over people, and it almost takes over. It takes over common sense and good sense and decency and morality. And it even comes across, you know, I'm reading, message boards for the local news, and like a piece of news will happen. I don't care if it's a cat stuck in a tree or if it's a drunk driver hits some. I mean, it's there's just some piece of news, and there's people that have to chime in a way. And I don't think this has always been like, maybe it's always been human nature. I don't know. But people chiming in a way to chip away at either some kind of moral construct or decency. People have to chip in and either fight, put down, belittle, hurt another person anonymously, or people they've never even had any kind of contact with whatsoever. And I see this more and more and more. And it's like it's kind of like a plague.
It is, my friend.
Yeah.
You're 100% right. And you know what it is? It's the anonymity that's associated with, there's no consequence for that action.
Mm.
Like, I'll give you a perfect example. There was a guy who really, really went beyond what you think, you know, like, you have trolls and haters. Like, this guy went way, way beyond what you should do. Like, he literally came to New Orleans.
I'm not talking about, like, people just talking shit. I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, yeah, I know what you're saying. It goes way beyond that. But I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, what I was saying is, the point I was going to make is, see, as long as there's anonymity, then that spirit can do what it does, because there's nothing, there's no checks and balances. And in this guy's case, you know, he went way beyond. He decided to come to New Orleans, and he ended up running into some people who know me, just randomly ran into some people who knew me. Like, it was almost like God's intervention, because he called himself, look, he just randomly ran into some people. And the dude calls me, hey, man, you know, I want to apologize. You know, I thought you were fake, and I thought you were this, but I actually ran into some people who know you, and they've known you for a long time, and, you know, blah, 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 blah. But because it's not real to them, and because it's over the internet, or because it's over a message board, because there's no consequence, then that spirit runs amok, and it spreads amongst people. It's almost like it's viral. You know, it truly is viral, and it spreads amongst people, and they just act a fool. And it's sad, but the minute, you know, you remove that digital construct, and those people are of flesh and blood and face to face, all that stuff stops. It just ends immediately. You know, it ends immediately. So
when we're able to interact, you know, as humans, face to face. Yeah. That's amazing, man.
Yeah, that's human beings.
Crazy world we live in, Dark. It's a crazy world.
It really is. You know, that reminds me of a story that, oh, wow, that really does remind me of one. So, and she'll be fine with telling the story.
Okay.
One of my favorite, all-time favorite people that are part of the Dark Waters family is a nurse out of New York, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember the name of the hospital because I don't intentionally remember the names, but so she's been working at this hospital for absolutely forever, like 15 years. Yeah, she's recently got married. And the reason why that reminds me of the story is because her husband was like one of those blogger guys who like literally spent his whole time at the computer. Like, she was like, yo, Doc, you know, this guy's like the biggest geek you'll ever meet. You know, my ex-husband was like the biggest nerd you'll ever meet. And she's at work one evening, and she's in this wing of the hospital that they're getting ready to close down. But they still have like half of a hallway in operation. The other half of the hallway, there's literally no patients in the rooms. It's just, you know, they're not using those rooms. So she's doing her night rounds, checking on people. And at the end of the hallway, she sees this guy walk out of one of the rooms. And he's dressed in like a black suit, black tie, white shirt. She says he's about 6'4". White guy. And so she sees him, and she's like, excuse me, sir, you know, that wing of the hospital is closed, you're going to have to come back this way. And she said she turned her head to look behind her back towards the desk, because she heard like a pencil or something fall at the little nurse's station desk, looks back, the guy's gone. She's like, okay, well, this guy's in the hospital. Let me go check and walk. So she walks down, checks all the rooms. Nobody's there. 2 days later, she sees the guy again. This time, he walks from one room into the next room. And she goes directly in that room and doesn't see him. A day later, someone working with her says, I saw this guy in the hallway. And he went to one of the rooms, and I couldn't find him. So now it's two people who've seen this guy, right? So she's hanging out at work. I think she said it had to be like the day after the other young lady saw him. She's hanging out at work, and she decides to go to the restroom. And she goes into the restroom, the ladies' room, and the way she described it was this. If you walk into the door swings open inward, right? On the left-hand side is a wall, and there's a long mirror, and there are three face poles. And these are the old-time face poles, nothing fancy. I mean, it's just like, if you can imagine the face poles that you had when you were a kid in your elementary school, that's what they were, right?
Okay.
And in front of you, directly if you're standing in that doorway, are these huge, huge, huge windows. And by huge, she said, you know, like 6 feet wide, and they opened up like 7 feet. Like, they were huge, like two of them. One of them was open, and she's like, you know, Doc, I was standing there washing my, use the bathroom, I was standing there washing my hands, and she says, now these windows are typically locked and latched open when they're open. And she's like, I'm sitting there washing my hands, and she says, this window slams down, like someone grabbed the top of it and rammed it down. And when she looks, she sees this man's face in the window, the same man's face that she saw in the hallway. And then the glass shatters. Like, so if you can imagine a window slamming down closed, you look, you would think that the pane of glass would shatter immediately, but it didn't. She looks and sees this man's face in the window, and then the glass shatters.
Oh, Jesus.
And she has this heavy, heavy, heavy New York accent. She's like, yo, dog, you know, she's like, I was so afraid that I bit through my lip. And I was like, wait, what, babe? She's like, I bit through my lip. Like, I literally bit through my lip. And I was like, well, how do you do that? She's like, I was afraid I bit through my lip. So she's standing there. The other nurses hear this commotion, and they come running. They come walking in. And she's just in shock. So her friend is like, you know, where are you bleeding from? Why are you bleeding? And the friend's talking, say, you're bleeding. What's wrong? And she's just standing there. And then they realize she bit through her lip. Her friend walks her out of there, gets her out of there, and she tries to tell her friend what happened. The friend kind of believes her but doesn't believe her. So she said that same night when she was headed home, when she left out of the hospital, she felt like something was with her. She said, when I got in my car and was headed home, I felt like something was with me. And she's like, Doc, I didn't know for sure that this thing was with me until I got to my front door of my apartment. She said, because when I put that key in the door, I felt like someone was standing right behind me, so much so that I turned around and looked over my shoulder to see if anybody was there. And she said she opened the door, went into the house and into her apartment. And from that day forward, her relationship with her husband changed. And a week later, it all culminated in him attacking her in the hallway. Like, the nerdy, goofy guy who played video games and literally was a traitor on a computer who trades, you know, currency trader, beat her up in the hallway of her house. And she was like, I knew this wasn't him. She's like, well, the way he came after me, the way he approached me, I knew this wasn't him. It didn't look like him. His demeanor had changed.
Right.
And he ends up hitting her and knocking her down, well, actually knocking her into the wall, and like a pitcher falls and hits her in the head. And when she gets up to go confront him to fight back, he snaps out of it. And she was like, dog, like, he snapped out of it, and he didn't even remember what he did. And I was like, yeah, that thing followed your man home and possessed him. And I said, well, how much longer did you have that kind of problem, that activity? She's like, well, I didn't have it too much longer after that, because you ain't going to hit on me. I don't care if you got a monster, a ghost, or a demon. I'm not staying in the house. She was like, so I rolled out, you know. He can have people possessed by whatever he want. And so it just reminds me of that, because we start talking about the technology and him being one of those techie guys, you know. It's just one of those things that is weird, man. And people have to be careful. They really do.
You know, I remember back in the day when I was in high school, we had a great old Irish Catholic priest come to our youth group, our church youth group, and he was talking to us about the dangers of the Ouija board. And one of the things that he was telling us, he's like, it's not like it's in the movies. Like, you're not going to be throwing a pea soup or things like that. But he says he's had to go into houses after teenagers were, you know, playing with an Ouija board and things like that. And what you notice is the breakdown of relationships. Things wedge, they wedge their way and infiltrate the relationships, and they break down. And he had to go in where people were, you know, goofing with an Ouija board, you know, at 1 minute and then doing something else. And then all of a sudden, they're fighting, you know, like just like that. They're fighting about who knows what. It didn't really make much sense to them as they looked at it later. But something kind of, like you said earlier, washed over them. And so, you know, like the Ouija board was kind of a conduit and a doorway to bring things into, you know, your reality. And I think a lot of ways that the internet and this interconnectivity between people might open the door to something, you know, something dark and sinister. So it's amazing, man.
I can promise you, dude. I can tell you for a fact, you know, I'm blessed to have two sons. I went through a divorce, but I'm blessed to have two amazing young men for sons. And I'm blessed to have the most phenomenal girlfriend on the planet. And there are times where she will snap me out of stuff. Like, I won't forget. I think it was like about, I think it was December of last year. It was coming up to the holidays. And I'm always grumpy around the holidays because my mom died close to the holidays. It's just all these emotions, right?
Sure.
And so we were coming up on the holidays, and I was talking to this guy for like a week. And it took a week to discover that this guy was dealing with something demonic. And as soon as I discovered it, I cut off the communications. Hmm. So she and I are hanging out, and she says, something came over me. I was being grumpy. And she looks at me and she says, you know, you're different right now. And she says, this is not the man that I love. She's like, the man that I love doesn't behave this way. She's like, he's patient, he's kind, he's sweet, he's funny. She's like, I don't know who you are right now, but whoever you are, you need to get the hell from around here. That's her exact words, right? And it snapped me out of it because I'm like, yeah, you know, that's not how I behave. And so you have to be careful. And that goes back to where I learned, you know, I learned how to put a protective hedge around me, my children, around her, around my family and extended family, because you do come under those influences if you don't pray to have a hedge of protection put around yourself, because we are human beings and we can be influenced. And it's amazing how many people are influenced on a daily basis. You think about it. You see someone who's driving down the street and they just have the most crazy, insane road rage on them you've ever seen in your life. And what makes a person go from 0 to 1,000 like that? The more I do this, the more I believe that all that is just spiritual. And all of it is the manifestations of something spiritual.
Oh, man. Amen. God bless you, brother. I mean, I've been thinking along those lines for a long time. I mean, what makes people snap like that? It's road rage. Yeah. I mean, like, you're just rolling down the, you know, you're just going down the street, and anything can set, you know, gentleman X off. And, it's wild to think about. And I appreciate the fact that you say you don't want to enter into those conversations specifically, because you don't want to open those doors. And I think those doors are very real. They're very tangible, and they do have lasting effects. So now I'm going to switch gears.
And you know,
well, go. I'm no, no, go, go, go.
Okay, go ahead.
No,
I was going to say is what I was going to say is that it's not necessarily that I don't want to open those doors. It's just that so for example, I'll give you a perfect example of why. Well, let's let this car pass, man, because this dude has a diesel truck. He just makes noise. I'll give you a perfect example of why I'm leery of those things, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about spirituality and spiritual entities. There's no way, and it's not like we're the Ghostbusters, right? You know, we don't have some kind of EMF meter that's like, you know, that's going to trap a spirit and we can look at it in a bottle. But what I've discovered is there's no way of knowing when a person contacts me if it's actually that person contacting me or that entity that's associated with that person contacting me.
Right.
And what they want or what it wants, you know? So, as I've done my studying and reading, I've discovered that because a lot of these spirits, the powerful ones, like the ones that I've encountered, because they are fallen angels and they seek worship and they seek attention. And that what better person to give them attention than someone to share their story, to tell the whole world what they're capable of doing. And when I actually was a guy named Kenneth Deal that brought this to my attention. And Kenneth said, hey, you have to be careful because of what God blessed you with. The gift he blessed you with is a curse. And I'm like, yeah, well, what are you talking about? And he broke it down, and I was like, whoa, okay, wow. I didn't think of it that way. He's like, so you never know why that person has contacted you. And so people say, well, you know, Doc, you talk a lot about cryptids and Dogman and Bigfoot and black eye kids, but you don't go into the demonic stuff. Well, I can't really decipher, you know, who's who and what's what. So the best thing I figured to do is just avoid it.
Well, and it's probably for your own good, honestly, man.
Yeah, it is.
Now, I'm taking a look at the clock on the wall, and we kind of talked about how much time that we had to talk tonight, and you know, I'm going to take your recommendation. We might have to make this a two-parter, because we've been talking about the spiritual realm and everything, but you've dropped the D word a couple times, and I'm really intrigued, because you seem to be like the preeminent knowledge on Dogman. And I'm just, I've been a lifelong Bigfoot nut, and I've been interested in ghosts and things like that and the paranormal. But this whole concept of Dogman, for my listeners, our listeners, who aren't familiar with what Dogman is or what we're talking about, could you give a Wikipedia? Can you kind of give like a dictionary definition of what we're talking about when we say Dogman?
Well, yeah, I'd be more than happy to give everybody kind of the lay of the land when it comes to this topic. So the Dogman topic has been around for a very long time. Actually, Linda Godfrey was the person 20 years ago who started writing about the Michigan Dogman. Anybody who's searching for information should start there and then work their way forward, right?
Sure.
Well, and essentially what this is, this creature is it's an upright walking canine. So if you would take a black timber wolf, right, a 450-pound black timber wolf, the biggest wolf you could find, give him the ability to stand up like a human being and walk on his hind legs, take his chest and his shoulders and multiply those by 20, literally by 20, and take the head and multiply it by maybe 7. That is what you're looking at when people start talking about Dogman. Now, there's different types, and because people want to monetize the subject, they'd be like, oh, they got a type 1, type 2, type 3, this, that, blah, 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 bada bing, bada boom. What you need to know is two things. Number one, if you are one of those, you guys are on a cornfield, so it's especially you guys.
All right.
Man, if you come across something that looks like a dog that's walking on two legs, you get to walk in the other way. And if you ever are out hunting and you see this thing, don't you think about shooting it. Don't you raise a weapon towards it. Don't you do nothing. Leave it alone. Because this creature is the most intelligent alpha predator on our planet right now. And I've talked to people who try to hunt them. I've talked to people who are cryptozoologists who know about them. I've been harassed over talking about the subject and had cars sitting outside of my house for a week straight. Because when I first came across the topic, I was like, yo, this is bull. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is bull. And then I decided I was going to go my silly behind to the location where they actually were supposed to be.
Oh, you did?
And found out that it was more than real. Yeah, man. When I started doing this, I started with, like, stories from people who were, like, direct friends of mine, people I've known that grew up here in the city of New Orleans, because you got enough paranormal stuff that happens in New Orleans to where you don't need to go outside the city. Like, everybody's neighbor has something. You know, everybody's friend has something.
Oh, yeah.
Well, when I heard about the Dogman topic, I said, well, let me see if anybody in my network knows anybody who's encountered this. And it was like the weirdest email. I think I still have it. I'm one of these days on my post so people can see. Because I felt crazy writing. Well, I started getting stories in. There was a guy named Skip out of Mississippi who had like a long, drawn-out Dogman encounter where he was working on a distribution line. In one of those bucket trucks, you know how they have the bucket trucks where they take you up to the top of the pole?
Yeah, we call them cherry pickers here.
Yeah, cherry pickers. Yeah. He was in one of those repairing some distribution lines after a storm and trying to get the power on for people. And his truck ended up being surrounded by these creatures. So I'm like, okay, he knows a good friend of mine. I'm going to go see him. And man, this dude, oh my God. We meet each other at this little restaurant, and we don't hit it off at first at all. It's kind of like, you know, he's skeptical about me, I'm skeptical about him. And I think we started talking about football. I can't remember what, I think we were talking about LSU and Ole Miss or something like that.
Okay.
And we started to hit it off. And then he's like, look, I'm going to take you and show you what people want to know. And so he drives me around through Taylor, Mississippi, all the way down to, I forgot the little town, down south of Taylor. And he's telling me about, hey, these people over here 6 years ago had Bigfoot problems. These people over here currently have Dogman problems. These people have special light bulbs on their house that they use to keep the Dogman alive. He's breaking it all down. I mean, like, and I'm in the car, like, okay, this is really real. Like, and he's like, look, I'm going to take you to where I had my encounter, and you're going to see for yourself. So, man, we drive around that whole morning, that whole day. We stop and get a little bit of bite to eat for lunch. We get towards the evening time, and we go to where this man had his encounter. We're literally where he had parked his truck. And we get out, and now I start going into kind of detective mode. So I'm trying to get him to tell me his story. And the minute he starts talking, I realize that everything he said was real because of his physical reaction to retelling the story. And if you've never seen, like, everybody's seen a grown person cry, right? Everybody has a kid. You know how when your kid is getting ready to cry, their eyes kind of well up?
Oh, you
can see the water forming in their eyes?
Yeah.
Well, he starts talking, and as he gets into the story, you start to see that water well up in his eye. Like, it's just getting ready to roll over the bottom of that eyelid and start coming down, but he's fighting it. And I'm like, okay, something happened to this dude. And then he's like, look, man, you know, it was one right here, and he points to the pole, and he's like, it was rubbing his back on the pole. And he was like, they all went in that direction when I shot the flare, and we're talking, and then, bro, oh my God, these crows, like, I'll never forget this. These crows are on the distribution line, and they're just, like, squawking, like two crows, like, yeah, making noise. But it's starting to get silent out there, but they're just hammering away at us, like, making a noise, and then they fly off. And then just, like, gone. And he's like, look, man, it's about to get dark. We need to leave. And he starts walking towards the truck. But I'm trying to get this man to tell me more of the story, so I'm lollygagging. Dude, didn't you hear what sounds like if someone was to take the biggest F-350 diesel truck you could find and start driving that truck through the woods, knocking over trees, just stuff breaking. But it sounds like more than just one thing running towards you. And I'm a city boy, so I mean, I've done a little bit of hunting, but I know that's not a normal sound. So he's like, man, you need to get in a truck now. And I'm like, man, what is that? He's like, that's definitely coming. You need to get in a truck now. And so he goes to the truck, gets in the truck, puts one leg in, his right leg is in the driver's side door, and he's holding on to the top of the door, and he's ready to hop in. I circle around because now I want to see what it is. Part of me actually wants to see, the other part of me doesn't want to see. So I circle around to the passenger side, but I make the mistake of not getting in a truck. I really do make that mistake of not getting in a truck. And so my butt, you know how you have the door, like if you're standing in the door of a car and the door can kind of rest along on your butt,
yeah,
like right on your backside?
Oh, yeah.
That's how I am. And I'm leaning around the kind of little back little bed window looking. So my head is kind of on an angle looking. And the next thing you know, this dude pulls off. Like he's gone. Boom.
Jeez.
I mean, gone. And when I'm talking about gone, I'm not talking about like pull off, you know, slow. I'm talking about like skeeting off, dust and a few rocks hitting me, and he's gone. I look over to my right because he's headed towards the right, and the door has swung back open, wide open, and then it's swinging back closed. And I stand there and watch him out, like turn the corner, not turn the corner, but turn this bend in the road. And by this time, man, it's just dark enough to where, you know, I can't really see anything. And now the woods have gone silent. Everything is dead quiet.
And he's like, gone. He's gone.
Gone, bro. Gone. His name is Skip. Skip is gone. Like, gone. And so I'm standing there. Now, you got to realize something. This is a regular two-lane roadway. And so we were parked on the opposite side of the road from the woods. And so I'm standing on that side of the road, which is not, like, I guess you would call it the, you got the little white line down the middle, then you got the line on the outside, and that little area towards the outside of that line, the side of the road.
Right.
And I'm standing there, and it hits me that, yo, this dude just left me. Like you know how you have this surreal moment where something actually hits you? And I don't know if most people have been through that. Well, it settles into your mind that, yo, I'm by myself.
Yeah, this is my reality right now.
Yeah, it hits you, man. It kind of like, it's like getting slapped in the face, like, wow, yo, you by yourself. And that's when I realized and noticed that it's so quiet that it hurts. Like, you know how it's so silent that it hurts your ears because it's silent?
Right.
It's so quiet that it's like hurting me. And I'm like, wait, it ain't supposed to be this quiet out here. This is the woods. You know, I'm from New Orleans. I grew up in New Orleans East. And I went in the woods as a kid. And it was all kind of crickets and this and that. But man, I'm like, yo, it's so quiet out here. It's hurting my ears. And that's not normal. Like, I'm in a vacuum. And so then my body kicked in and my senses started kicking in. Like, I guess it was your primal senses start kicking in. Because now I'm starting to feel things. Not hear things, but feel things. Like, I'm starting to sense something or someone there. Like, you know, I guess that's what we, you know, I don't know how to describe it, but I know something's there. There's no doubt about it. I know because I can feel it. It's like this energy. It's almost like when someone's looking at you in a crowded room and you look over and you catch this person looking at you, they're staring at you. Maybe they got lock eye and they're staring. It's the same thing.
Oh yeah. It's that,
I get that same feeling.
It's that sensory perception that you get that somebody's locking in on you.
Yeah, but take that and multiply that times like 1,000. Like, it wasn't like a good feeling. I mean, it was like, you know.
And plus, you don't know where the hell you are.
No, you don't know where the hell you are, but the feeling was like, it was like I felt like something was there and it had intent.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying? It's not like if you're sitting in a, it's not like you go out to have dinner and, you know, you catch someone looking at your girl. You know, you got a pretty girl, you can feel a guy looking at your girl and look over, he looking at your woman. It's not that.
No.
If that intent is in that feeling, like, you feel that person's intent when they're looking, but you take that same intent and you just multiply it over and over and over and over. And it was just so strong. And I'm like, oh my God, something's there. So much so to the point to where I knew, you know, fight or flight was going to kick him in. And it was kicking in, and I couldn't run nowhere. So I actually took a step forward into the road and squared my feet up. Like, literally, I twisted the palms of the balls of my feet into the ground to prepare myself. Because I'm like, something over there, and it's coming. And I raised my arms up, and I raised my fists up. And I was like, look, if this is a man, he about to get it. But if it's something else, then we just got to do what we do. And as I'm raising, like, my arms and my hands up, that's when I realized how afraid I was because, you know, I was trained in Aikido, Taekwondo, and I've been in a number of fights. I mean, I've broken hands and snapped fingers out of place. And, dude, I've never felt this flush feeling come over me because it's an adrenaline pump. It's like you get an adrenaline rush, and I know how to force myself to do it. You got to go, and you breathe out, and it forces that adrenaline in to your body. Well, I do that, and then it rushes back out, which I've never felt before. It's like it goes away, and then my bladder feels like it's about to empty. Like, it's replaced by this sense of fear, and I'm about to pee my pants. And I'm like, oh, my God, this ain't normal. This is not normal. And now I'm really, really getting afraid, man. I'm starting to sweat, and then I hear his truck starting to, like, I hear him hitting the brakes. You actually hear, Stir! You can hear the tires screeching and kind of hopping on the road. And then you hear his engine just rev go. I mean, it was so loud. It was beautiful. And within about 20 seconds, he was flying back around that curb. And he pulls up right, like almost rolls over my feet, pulling up right up on me. And he's cursing and screaming and get your in the car. What are you doing? Like, he's just going crazy. And I try to hop in the bed of the car because it's better the truck because I'm not going to, you know, run around to the passenger side. So I keep trying to hop in. It took me about 3 times to realize that I needed to jump onto the back tire then hop into the bed of the truck. So finally we get in the truck and pull off. And we get about 1.5 to 2 miles down the road. And he stops and I get in and there. I mean, this guy had this knockdown, drag out fight, like verbal fight. Like, I'm spazzing out on this dude like I'm Kanye West. Until my anger tapers down. And I look in his eyes, because you know how you get blinded by anger? Like, you're just so mad that you're not aware I wasn't really aware of everything I was saying, but I knew what I was saying. It was so intense because I was like, dude, this thing could have ate me, whatever it was. And I was just spazzing. And I make eye contact with him, that strong eye contact, and his eyes are welling up again. And he's like, dude, I didn't do that on purpose. I wouldn't do that to any man on purpose after what I've been through. I would never do that to you. And I realized that he's not lying. Like, he was scared for his life.
Mm-hmm.
And so I apologized to him. I said, hey, man, I'm sorry. I said, I'm freaking out. You freaking out. He's like, I told you. And we ended up going to a ballroom, dude. We just sitting there drinking. And he was like, bro, I tried to tell you. You didn't believe me. I'm like, bro, what was that? He was like, that was them. I was like, well, how many? He said, probably 3 or 4. And I told him, I said, why did it go so quiet? He's like, I don't know. That's what happened to me. And he's like, describe the silence to me. I was like, it hurt my ears. He's like, that's what happened. It went so silent to me that, dude, like, literally, it hurts because there's no sound. Like, no sound. Like, everything has vacated. Like, every little critter, every little creepy crawly, all of them, like, to hell with this, we leave, and these things are here. And that was my encounter with these creatures. And from there, I took it serious, and I started, when people would call, I started taking mental notes of, you know, the common things and the common themes and the things that all were the same. And I started throwing out the things that I knew just didn't kind of fit this common theme. And so over time, I kind of developed a great understanding of it and what's going on with the phenomenon. I just haven't understand the human aspect of it, where we as human beings are so attracted to it. I understand what they are now, and I understand where they come from now, the two kind of roads, the paths that they could come from. But our fascination with them, I still haven't been able to understand, because we are fascinated with these things. I don't know why, but we are.
You know, two things I was struck by when I was listening to your story. Did you feel any, I don't know, like you've been there before, like you told the story, you know, yeah, because you were telling that story earlier when you were 12, in between the two houses on the property when you were a kid, and you saw those red eyes beyond the light, and it was kind of watching you and whatnot. Did you feel like maybe, like when you were 12, that was an earlier encounter with a species like that?
No, there's nothing. These two feelings were nothing similar
okay.
at all.
Okay.
What I felt on the side of that road was like it was the same feeling that I would get as a kid when I was walking down that street and the neighbors had that big dog in the fence,
mm-hmm.
and they had a little short little metal fence, and that dog could hop that fence, and that same flush fear, like, I want to run away. I want to get away. It could kill me. You know what I'm saying? When I was a kid, what I felt was a fear of, like, this thing was coming to actually take my soul when I was a kid.
Like,
it was coming to take more than just my physical essence. It was coming to take the what made me me.
I gotcha.
Like, that's what I felt as a kid. This felt like something was going to rip me the hell apart. Like, something was going to eat me is what I felt.
Well, the second thing that I was thinking of when you were telling the story is that I've been getting into the work and the investigations of David Pilates with his missing 411. And a lot of those stories in there, now he never comes right out because he's former cop and he's just kind of just reporting the facts and letting you draw your own conclusions. But so many of those stories are so peculiar that it's these people are disappearing in national parks under weird circumstances. Experienced hikers. I could talk for hours on that subject, and David would be the one that would have to really talk about it. But you said earlier that these dogmen are like the apex number one predators on planet Earth, just the perfect predator machine, walking on Earth, not a shark or anything like that. It seems like there's something that's kind of covered up or hidden. People don't want to talk about, they don't want to report about. There's something out there that it's out, something's out there, and people are, real people are disappearing. Real people are turning up dead. Real people are
yeah.
Yeah.
There's no way to explain that though. Like, what do you tell the public? I'll tell you a quick story. So one of the things that I've been able to do, and one of the reasons why I believe that I had people sitting outside of my house for a week, was because I ended up infiltrating part of the fish and wildlife organizations in a couple of states, right? I get a call from a guy in Mississippi. He says, hey, man, I got something you'd be interested in. Okay, well, what is it? He says, well, have these cabins that have these metal doors on them, right? He said, I'm going to tell you a story, and you tell me what you think. He said, but just remember, it's just a story. I said, okay, which is his way of telling me, I'm going to tell you this, but you didn't hear this from me. He says, two men come up to a cabin because it's their job to check to make sure that everything's okay, and the metal door is ripped off and thrown into the driveway. Inside the cabin, there's claw marks across the log cabin, the logs, like huge claw marks, all on the ceiling, all on the walls, the kitchen, the cabinets in the little kitchen of the cabin are ripped out with claw marks, and there are these trail cameras in there, and they've been urinated on. And the strongest smell of urine we've ever, you know, the men have ever smelled in their life. What would you think did that, is what he said. I said, well, it sounds like one of those, you know, doggy men creatures. You know, we were on the phone because I know those phone calls are always mine. I was like, sounds like one of those doggy men creatures. He said, I don't know. You know, maybe it was somebody's wife who got mad at him. Because that's how we're going to write the report up. And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, that's how we're going to have to write the report up. I was like, what? He's like, yeah, that's how it's being written up. He's like, hey, I'm going to call you back later, buddy. Good talking to you. And that's how the story ended, and that's how the phone call ended. But it was written up as someone's wife got mad. It was a domestic dispute. But the metal door was ripped off the cabin, claw marks all over the walls, claw marks all through the cabinets. Like, do you know how those wooden kitchen cabinets? Claw marks all through that. And trail cameras left in the middle with urine on them. And it's written up as a domestic dispute. So I guess that will answer, that kind of answer, is there a little bit of a cover-up going? Of course there is. There's no way they couldn't be.
Yeah. You know, I mean, there's dozens and dozens of people missing in parks. I mean, from all over. And it goes back decades. And you know, they won't find anything on these people. Or they'll find parts of them or articles of their clothing in impossible distances away from where they were last seen, and just under the strangest, weirdest circumstances, especially with people that, I mean, we're not talking about a guy like me going out in the mountains that's never been out there, that's never hiked or really camped in his life, really. These are like people that's all they do since they were children. So it's amazing. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that they don't keep records of complete records of who's missing on national park property. And that's the thing that, it's criminally negligent and incompetent, but I don't believe they're being negligent or incompetent. I think they know exactly what's going on, and how can they not when they're investigating?
You couldn't pay me to go to a national park and spend a night camping. You couldn't pay me money to do it. We'll give you, he's like, now I'll give you 100 million bitcoins. Oh, no, not gone. No.
Right, no.
Keep your bitcoin.
No. I would not do that either. So before I'm looking at the clock, and I know you got a busy schedule. So let's turn our attention a little bit, and maybe we'll do a part two on some of the other things I wanted to talk about. But I really wanted to get your I got you on the line. Your kind of perspective on Bigfoot and Sasquatch, because I've been on some kind of other podcasts as a guest and talking, you know, with a panel about Sasquatch and Bigfoot and things like that. And it's just always fascinated me since I was little, just like with Leonard Nimoy and In Search Of, and just all the different books and Bigfoot Encyclopedia that I've read. And I know that you've heard stories from people, and that you relate it on your website and on your YouTube channel, and there's subscriptions, and people need to really just dive into what you do. I mean, we're getting a really nice, tasty bite here on the Necronomicast, what you do. But can you tell us a little bit about like maybe an interesting or a kind of a creepy Bigfoot story that you've heard from somebody that's contributed to you?
Yeah, I'll tell you one that someone called and told me 2 nights ago. First of all, I'll just tell everybody you can find all my content at iamdarkwaters.com. You can find free content, and there's premium content where you pay $3.99 a month, but you get movie quality stories for $3.99 a month. But just recently, while I was doing a stream, I got a call in where a lady was talking about as a kid how she and her sister were left at home alone, and they were actually in the same bed sleeping, and they hear this huge commotion, like this huge commotion. The parents had been gone, and as kids, they were like, oh, I don't want to get up. I'm scared. They didn't want to get out of the bed. Well, next thing you know, she describes it as a hairy man that had to dip his head down and turn his shoulders to come into their bedroom, comes into their bedroom and sniffs them, like smells them, like sniffs, like literally puts his nose to them and sniffs them.
So
he puts his nose to them and sniffs them.
Like he's looking for something to eat.
And then turns around and I don't know what that was about, but sniffs them and takes deep inhaled breaths of their scent. Stands there for a second looking at them and then turns, twists his shoulders, dips his head, goes back out of that bedroom door. And I said, well, what did you do, you know, as a kid? You know, how did you react? She's like, we were so afraid that we just didn't move. We held the covers up to our, they said they pulled the covers up to their nose so where their eyes were outside of the cover, but nothing else but their eyes and the top of their head. And they said they stayed that way. And they didn't move until the parents got home. When the parents got home, they flipped out. It was like, why is the back door broken open? And why is this that? And why, you know, what are y'all doing? You know, but they were two little girls and wasn't nothing that they could eat. And it's just, as far as to answer the question about, you know, kind of what Bigfoot is, I've had 2 years to try and figure out what it is. I can't tell you exactly what it is and where it comes from. I can only tell you that, again, going back to all the spiritualities part and the spiritual side, I'm leaning towards when it comes to Bigfoot that they are Nephilim. On Dogman, the more I dig into Dogman and the more encounters I hear of Dogman, I'm starting to think that those are some kind of a genetically modified version of spliced up creature. You know what I'm saying? It makes no sense, some of the things that I'm hearing about them doing and some of the stories. And I mean, I can tell you some of those stories when we do our next show, which I promise you we'll do another one.
Oh, yeah.
So
going back, so I always had kind of the idea, and I've read different books that it's interesting that you say that you think Sasquatch is more Nephilim. I always kind of pictured as Sasquatch Bigfoot as kind of that kind of brother tribe descendants of, you know, kind of an offshoot of, I don't want to say Native American, but you know, that whole pilgrimage, you know, through Asia and the Bering Strait and all that, just like, you know, like the brother tribe kind of a thing, like more humanoid than, I guess Nephilim. I always think of like the literal translation of like, what is it? Like son of, like sons of God and daughters of men kind of a thing. And,
well, I may be using the wrong terminology. Nephilim, I think the other one is Raphilim, but basically the Bible says that when the sons of God came to the earth, they corrupted all the seeds of the earth, meaning they corrupted every animal, everything that they could corrupt, they corrupted it, right?
Okay.
So there's that thought process. And then there's the thought process that the Sasquatch were the pre-Adamic race that were here before the garden, God created man in the Garden of Eden.
Okay.
And then there's the thought process that, you know, they are some kind of genetically spliced human beings. And then there's the whole alien concept where they come from out of portals and they're invisible. And so there's four or five different lines of thought on it. I don't know if any one of them are exactly correct because I don't have one, you know, it's not like he rises with me to work in the morning, but,
right.
But I'm open to all of them. I'll say that, you know, I'm open to all of them. I'm leaning towards the Nephilim one because some of the stories that I'm hearing make a lot of sense, and it kind of falls in it, especially the sizes that I've heard. Like some of the sizes that I've talked to people about, some of the sizes are just, it's insane. I mean, it's literally as tall as your house. They're 12 feet, 13 feet tall. And the guys that are sharing those stories are military contractors. These guys are not lying. These are not the kind of guys that lie to you. They don't call you they don't seek attention. They're just, you know, that's just not what they do.
True.
Those guys are built cut from a different cloth, and they're not going to lie. Now, when we start getting to them coming out of portals and all the rest of that stuff, I tend to find that those people are like, are you going to share my story? You going to share my story? You going to share my story? I'm like, no, I'm not telling that story.
Sure.
That can make me sound like a fool. So.
Sure. Well, I can appreciate that. I mean, I mean, you've got all kinds of people that you're talking to and all kinds of sources, and I respect that I respect that you know how to discern what you are hearing and make good sense out of it. But real quick with the dog man, did you say you were leaning more toward like a genetic kind of mishap or something like that?
I mean, something done on purpose.
Yeah.
It has to be something done on purpose. And the difference between, like, for example, I talked to gentlemen who were contractors that had to actually shoot Bigfoot and try and kill Bigfoot. And they'll tell you, hey, man, you know, the last moments I recognized the humanity in this thing's eyes, because they've killed men before, and they say, man, there's a look in a man's eye before you kill him, and it's a look of regret and remorse. You can see it. I saw it in this creature's eyes, and that wasn't the first time that I've talked to someone who's had to shoot at one of these creatures, and they consistently describe that. The people who made the mistake of shooting at Dogman, they don't describe that, and the people who had a conflict with Dogman, they don't describe any humanity. They don't describe anything. They just describe this cold-blooded, pretty much killing machine once it gets going. Now, they consistently say, and they've consistently told me, hey, man, you know, one guy told me, man, I had one on my property for a long time, and we didn't have a problem because it would stay on all fours, and it would come and go every now and then. I'd see it walk, but it never bothered me. And he didn't have a problem until he had a guest come over, and the guest started shooting at it, and that's when he had a problem.
Oh.
So, but once the guest shot at it, it wasn't. He said, man, this thing is a monster. He's just a monster. But he calls it the Rougarou. He doesn't call it dog, man. He calls it the Rougarou. He said, Rougarou's a monster, period. He's like, once you look in his eyes, you realize, like, it never considered him to be a threat because it could kill him at any time. But he said, the minute that this thing was shot at, he said he realized how monstrous it was. Because of the way it behaved. And he's like, man, you know, I don't ever want to encounter it again. I never want to encounter it again. And he's like, I was like, well, people describe there being humanity and Bigfoot's eyes. What did you see in his eyes? He said, I saw that it wanted to kill me. And I mean, he was adamant about it. He said, it wanted to kill all of us. He said, I think there was just too many of us at that point in time, but it wanted to kill all of us. And I was like, wow. So I'll tell you that whole story the next time we do the show with Rhyme. I'll tell you that whole story. But, it's just one of those things, man. I think there's a distinct difference between the two creatures.
Unbelievable, man. I got more than I bargained for when I asked you to be on the show. ladies and gentlemen, dear listeners, I've had I don't even want to say it was a pleasure. I've just been enthralled sitting here. Usually longtime listeners in the show know that I'm not at a loss for words very often, but I have really enjoyed using my ears and not my mouth tonight with Dark Waters, and you can find more of him at iamdarkwaters.com, the king of YouTube horror. And it's true. These are true stories. This isn't stuff out of his imagination. He hears these stories, he discerns them, he investigates them, and it's been a real pleasure talking to you, DW. We got to do this very soon, and I'll maybe after we get off the line here, we can maybe set something up, because I got to talk to you about it. I was like, man, I got to talk to him about black-eyed kids. I got to talk to him about ghosts. And I want to talk like vampires and kind of the dark seediness of New Orleans, a town that I've been
in. We got to do the vampires, bro. We got to do the vampires next.
Oh, hell yeah.
I'm telling you, bro, you're going to freak. You're going to be like, what? You're like, wait, what? We're going to do the vampires next year. Now, I'd be more than happy to come back, buddy.
Oh yeah, man! It's been a real pleasure. And I'll tell you, I've been in New Orleans once in my life. I went down to visit a buddy who was a jazz student at Loyola University, and I got mugged at gunpoint by Tulane University and him when we were going to one more bar. Brian, hey, let's go to one more bar. So I got mugged in New Orleans. They took my watch and $30, but I've got stories about it now. So New Orleans, baby.
Yeah, that's New Orleans, man. That's New Orleans. You just got to be careful. People, you have fun, but you got to be careful, man.
Oh, they saw me coming a mile away, man. A little cornhusker like me. Crazy,
it's
man.
All right. We got Uber now, bro. It won't happen to you again. Just hop an Uber. You'll be all right.
That's right, man. It's the internet, man. Isn't it great? The internet. All right, DW. Listen, man. Hold the line. I'm going to say goodnight to our listeners. And then I want to chat with you just for a quick second off the air. So, everybody, Dark Waters has been our guest on this special episode of the Necronomicast, and so please check him out at iamdarkwaters.com. Go to YouTube and type in Dark Waters and just listen to his free content, and for the love of God, give him a couple bucks and listen to the rest, because he's got some crazy stuff out there. Stuff that, like I said, is real, and you won't hear it anywhere else. So I'm glad we were able to bring him here for you tonight. So on behalf of Wayne, Lori, Zip, and Doug, this is Brian. Thank you for listening. Boom.
That was going to be good.
You've been listening to the Necronomicast, a podcast hosted by a bunch of bloodbags and produced by Brian Corey and Wayne Brecky. For show notes and other interesting information, go to the show page at necronomicast.com. And until next time, find something better to do with your time.